Hello, everybody. Welcome to Adventure Mode. As always, I'm Dustin Furman, and alongside me, the most glorious ginger, Brandon. What's up? How are you?
I'm feeling better than ever.
That's good. I have a question for you, but I'll get back to it. We have a very special guest on the show today, and that's our friend David J. Tate. I made sure to include that middle initial. Is that important? No,
it's super important because otherwise you don't know which Dave. There's like hundreds of David Tates in the world. So
really?
I could be, well, maybe not 100. I don't know how many there are, but there's a lot. Like, there's a David Tate. Like, if you just go to DavidTate.com, it might not be DavidTate.com. I can't talk. Might just be DavidTate.com. I don't know. But he makes shoes, like ladies' footwear.
Oh.
And I guess he's really good at it because every now and then I meet a girl and she's like, oh, I love David Tate's shoes. You don't know him, do you? You know, I'm like, no, it's just
you
my name.
You should just play it off like, yeah, baby, what size What's do you up? Wear?
Guys, I have no game. I can't. I wouldn't be able to
I just
do
made the
like
game
that.
For you. There you go.
See, I thought, because I, on my like resume and stuff like that, I put Dustin T. Furman just because it sounds more
professional
sounding.
Yeah.
Maybe it might just be more pretentious though in my case because I'm just throwing in for fun. You have a practical reason though.
And then they will know your initials are DTF.
That is true. I'm always so DTF.
He's been DTF since birth.
That's actually not true.
As a baby.
I was DTF at birth because I originally just had my mom's old last name because my parents weren't married when they got had me.
Okay.
So there's some insider information for all of our listeners out there.
Good to know.
So
I'll keep that in mind.
Keep it in mind, yeah. David, you're on a podcast. Tell us a little bit about it.
Oh, I thought you meant right now. Yes, I am right now.
You're on this podcast. That's, that's something.
Tell us about us.
No. I'm on a podcast called the Super Best Friends Video Game Sleepover, or SBFVGS for short. And we just kind of talk about video games, kind of like what you guys do.
Yeah,
so,
it's a good show. It's longer than our show.
Good vibrations.
we try so hard to make it like an hour, but it always ends up like almost 2 hours. And we just like talking to each other, I guess. I don't know.
I want to write a theory that like the more people you have in your podcast, you should just add like 30 minutes.
Huh.
Because when
we
have multiple
good.
People, we always go
over
way longer than when it's just Brandon and I. So,
yeah, or maybe the people you're having are just like really awesome.
Might, I don't know. I mean, potentially.
There's a variable in there, amount of awesome.
That was like a humble brag.
Maybe. So, I enjoy your show very much so. I like the fact that you guys only do it every other week, partially just because it's easy to keep up with. Do you have that problem with podcasts? It's like you get behind. And then it's like, ugh.
I'm way behind right now. I actually, there's a podcast I listen to called Comedy Bang Bang,
which is
hilarious. But whenever they do a week where they have two episodes, like it just screws everything up. Because every now and then they'll have a week where there's just two episodes. And like right now I'm like trying to catch up on Thursday's episode.
Meanwhile,
there's a Monday one and I've got all these other ones I got to listen to. I just can't keep up. It's too much.
So you've told us about your podcast. Now tell us just a little bit about yourself, if you can.
All right. Well, I'm kind of a boring guy. No, I'm just kidding. I live in New York City. I like it. It's kind of cool. I never thought I'd live here in my life, but I do visual effects for a living. So I do compositing specifically, if you know what any of this means. What I do a lot is like I'll take a shot and remove the wires from it. Like say they do some crazy flip or something that they couldn't do in real life, and I'll paint out the wires, stuff like that. And I've worked on, I've worked on Jessica Jones
and
Daredevil.
That's the one. Yeah. That's pretty sweet.
My girlfriend.
I know spoilers from
Jessica
season
Jones.
Two of Daredevil, but I'm not going to tell you because
Whoa.
I'll get in trouble.
Wow.
Right here on this show, we'll get a million views.
No,
please.
I can't do it. I can't. But, and then I worked on, Love the Coopers, which was not that great of a movie. But, hey, it was my first on-screen credit for a movie. So
there you go. That's something.
Yeah.
That's very cool. We're kind of in the same family of work, you and I. But we're not with me doing video editing.
Oh, that's right. You do, video editing.
Yeah.
That's right.
So I have no clue how you do what you do at all. That's good. That's very good.
I don't either. I kind of like sit down at a computer, I get my shot, and I just like kind of go into the zone and like that's it, you know?
Yeah.
So like I don't even know. I'll wake up you know, 8 hours later and the shot's like done. No, I'm just kidding. It does though kind of feel a little bit like you have to like alter your brain to not think about how long everything you're doing is taking, because otherwise it can be a little bit, you know, disheartening. So
you just black out and then it's done.
Yeah, just black out. You wake up, you don't know where you are, but your shot's done and your pants are on the ground.
And you're sweaty and covered in mayonnaise.
What you hope is mayonnaise.
What you hope is mayonnaise.
Hey, but it pays the bills, right?
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Cool. Awesome. Well, we're very excited to have you on the show. You're our first Skype guest on this show. So we're trying to expand a little bit.
I actually bought this webcam just for this. So whoa. I hope it looks okay.
You're doing some of that YouTube Let's Play stuff as well. So are you going to use the webcam as part of that?
I don't know. I know some people want that sort of thing. But I know personally when I'm watching a, you know, person play a game, I actually don't want to see their little self in the corner. Because I'd rather just see the game, you know, like all of it. So, you know, I don't have a green screen or anything like that. So yeah. I don't know. Let's put it this way. If enough people ask me to, then I will. But as it is right now, not even that many people watch me stream live anyway when I do it. So,
yeah.
It's just something I do for fun when I have free time, which is very rare.
So, yeah. So, yeah. Awesome. Cool. Well, hey, before we get started with the show, we have something very special to talk about with the few people that do listen to the show. We're launching a new podcast tomorrow, Thursday. Brandon, tell us about the new podcast.
Our new podcast is called Dev Tales, and we are super excited about this venture. It's about developers and their tales in the simplest form, Dev Tales.
Like Sonic's friend Tales?
Yeah.
Similar.
How does he spell? Is it he actual, like, well, he has multiple tales, so it's T-A-I-L-S, right?
Yeah, T-A-I-L-S, yeah.
Yeah.
But it is about their games and, you know, what they had to do to get where they are. You know, it's a little bit more than just the game, but it's the people behind it, so.
Yeah, and we've been talking about the show for, like, since the end of December, so we're finally have our first episode out. We have Benjamin Rivers coming on, who worked on, he made the game Home, and he's also working on a new game called Alone With You, and he's super, super awesome, and we're very, very appreciative of him for coming on our show, and it's going to be awesome. I'm really excited for people to hear it. So tune in tomorrow. Make sure you search out Dev Tales. It's going to be awesome. Brandon, you look super excited about our new show.
I just keep thinking about how he's from Toronto, where Drake is.
He's been in the same vicinity, so that's important.
The Raptors.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is super important.
Okay, so let's get into our side quests, our first main segment, and one of the only segments, I guess, of this show. So there's a new Doom trailer out, and with a new release date as well. Not a new one. I guess this is the first time they've announced the release date, and that is May 13th. Have you guys seen the trailer?
I have seen it, but I kind of forgot about it.
I'm in the same boat.
Super excited about it, though.
Yeah, I mean, I watched the trailer, and I thought, I'm like, okay, this doesn't really look like anything new from the stuff we saw at E3.
Mm-hmm.
It looks fun. It looks interesting. I'm already worried that so the big thing it showed off in the trailer and at E3 was like it shows this like animation that happens when you like cut somebody in half or chop somebody up. And it just seems like it could get really annoying if it's like, okay, every 5 seconds I'm doing this chainsaw animation, kind of like Gears of War. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah. I actually have a story with that. There was ads on Facebook for this trailer.
I think I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
So it would play like Doom. It would come up with a title, and then it would like start to play it, and there would be texts over blurry video. And it's like, oh, well, if you want to watch more of this entire censored video, you need to go to this link and do this. And I'm like, just fucking show me the video. Yeah. I don't need.
It sounds like super clickbaity.
And then I kept trying to click on the video, and like, I don't know. I don't know what was going on. Doom. How about no?
It's interesting because it looks like they're trying in some way to do like a return to form with Doom, but it's I don't know if it's quite working. So I'm very curious. I'm curiously optimistic about this game.
Now, yeah, I would say, I mean, I've heard a lot of good things about it. I actually just watched the trailer again to refresh my memory. And it looks pretty cool. How about that cover, though? That box that looks like every other game that exists right now, like Master Chief and Call of Duty. Have you seen the box art that they released?
Yeah, I was going to mention that and ask you specifically, because I know you have that, design mind. I was like, man, as soon as I saw that, I was like, why did they think that this was going to sell copies of this game?
I don't know. It's so generic. It does not look like, when I look at it, I don't think about, that's the guy from Doom, to me, it looks like skinny Master Chief with a little bit of Call of Duty filters thrown on top.
I think it was a NeoGAF thread where they put all the different game logos over it. And there was one that for that really terrible Bomberman reboot on Xbox 360. And it was awesome. So perfect.
Yeah.
So it should be interesting. Brandon, you're real hyped about this game.
Yeah, I actually just played, I mentioned this, I think, maybe on our other podcast. I played Doom 3 the other night, which is nothing like the old Dooms, and that's why people didn't like it as much. It's more of a horror one. Played it on 360. It was the first time I ever played it. It was really interesting, but I used to play the old ones back on Windows 94, or 95, rather.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Something like that. Whatever my dad had, I think it might have been Doom 1 or 2, and I always thought it was just hella fun. As a child, I wasn't really able to fully experience it, but I'm excited, to say the least.
Now, Doom 3, I remember playing that. I think we were in, third grade, 2003 when that came out, maybe?
Oh, sorry, I just felt really old for a second.
It's okay. I remember that game scaring the shit out of me.
Yeah.
As a kid. And, I remember the part. So, did you play up to the, when you're in the room and all the weird pentagrams and blood start showing up?
Yes, yes.
It's really, it's real freaky. Yeah,
I played for about an hour and a half, two and a half hours, and I got to the part with those weird ass dogs and shit, and, and just a bunch of strange ass shit was happening. So super excited about that. It looked way more, this new one looks way more fast paced, and that's what you said, they're trying to return to form, because the old ones were just dashing through levels and just running and around.
Not scary at all. No, I mean, scary creatures, yeah. I guess.
I mean, I would say when I was a kid, because when I was, younger is when the original Doom came out. And that was one of those games where I would load it up and I was still not numb to killing hundreds of people like I am now. Because of video games and in real life, the video games.
Jesus.
So I would feel bad everything I killed in that game. And now, it's totally different. So I would load it up and I would start cringing and stuff. So I was a little scared when I played it.
Interesting.
It was a different time and I'm an old man. So
I kill things and I don't even think about it now.
We're very desensitized.
What have I become?
What have we all become? I mean, it's not just you. It's all of us.
No, but listen, I want the old health bar system. I want to be able to see my face getting fucked up.
Didn't?
That's all I'm saying. That was the coolest fucking thing when I played Doom 1.
That was pretty awesome.
Because, how cool was it? I almost wanted to die because I wanted my face to bleed. It's just a badass. You know what I mean?
You know, Wolfenstein didn't quite have the face mess up thing. But when you picked your difficulty at the beginning of Wolfenstein, it had the same type of pictures. If you picked the easy difficulty, it showed BJ as a little baby.
I remember that.
they kept that in the new one. So maybe there'll be some kind of reference like that. That'd be nice.
Yeah, I feel like they really do need to return to their roots. Connect it with the game. Don't just use the Doom name because people recognize it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So. It is interesting. You can tell they're with the speed. I think they emphasized at E3, they're this is the fast Doom that people want. So I'm curious how that will pan out.
Yeah, and that's, I don't even know.
Yeah.
I don't even know what I'm trying to say, but I was thinking back to what you were saying about those animations getting really old. And I'm worried about that too, honestly, because as someone who loves those animations, I think they're great for about the first three times you play the game. When I played Mortal Kombat X, it's great when I chop people's heads off and stuff, but it happens 5,000 times. So.
Well, that's the thing with Gears. You're super excited the first time you chainsaw an enemy in half in Gears, and then you do it again and again and again, and then eventually it has no meaning, which is sad. Think about the fact that you're wow, there's no meaning in me chainsawing somebody in half anymore. Back to the being desensitized.
Yeah, no, seriously.
First world.
And I mean, so the way I see that working is if there's like hundreds of different animations that happen and you don't see the same one like over and over too many times, then awesome. I'm all for it. I think it'll be awesome. But yeah, if they just keep repeating them, like, I just can't imagine that'll like hold up for a whole game.
Has there ever been a game that has had more than like three or four animations though? That's what I wonder.
I think that Uncharted series, like, they started like finding ways to stream animation off the disc while you're playing so that they could, like, every time Nathan Drake like touches a wall or something, he's like, you know, doing something different.
Specifically, I think you're thinking of Uncharted 3, right?
Yeah, Uncharted 3. They were streaming animations off the disc.
Yeah.
Just to you know, keep it fresh.
Yeah. I wonder if they could do something like that with, you know, chainsawing, chopping, stuff like that. So,
yeah, just more gruesome stuff than Uncharted.
You know what?
Uncharted.
Now that I'm thinking about it, too, The Witcher added new executions and everything. That would be something that would be interesting. Even if they did it where, you know, you're used to the same animations for 3 or 4 or 6 months, and then they come out with an update, and then look at all these new animations.
New ways to kill.
New ways to be like savage.
That. Yeah. Okay, so let's move along here. So, really exciting announcement from last week, I think. LEGO Star Wars The Force Awakens has been officially announced June 28th. I am super, super pumped. David, have you ever played LEGO Star Wars at all?
Yes, like way back when the first one came out, someone had it and I was over their house and they were like, here, check this out. And you know, it was pretty fun. I for some reason, I never really got into the Lego games. So I don't want to be like the downer, but
you're a big Force Awakens fan. So
no, I saw that movie 4 times. I kind of want to see it again before it's too late to see it in theaters again. I don't know. 5 might be too many times.
I'm going for my 3rd time, I think in the next 2 days. So I'm not quite at your level yet.
Get on my level, Dustin.
Yeah. No,
So I really like it. I like, you know, I love Star Wars. Like, I'm a huge Star Wars fan. I have Star Wars everything. I'm looking at a Star Wars R2-D2 Pez dispenser over there. And, you know, so I'm a big fan. But the Lego games, for some reason, they tend to not, like, hold my interest for very long. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think maybe the gameplay might be too simple for me. And like, I found that to be the case. Like, actually, I bought a Lego game about 2 years ago or so, back when I got my PS4. I got that Marvel Lego Superheroes game.
And I think I know what you're going to say, because I think I had the same experience.
Maybe. So I had my PS4 down with me in North Carolina visiting my family, and my nephew was over and we were playing it. And like, after about 30 minutes or so, he looked over at me. He's like, can we play something else?
Yeah.
Like, he was just bored. and I was already bored too, obviously, at that point. And so I don't know. I feel like maybe I don't give the Lego games a fair enough chance, maybe, because people seem to love them. So there must just be something wrong with me, right?
I mean, what's funny is I got Lego Marvel also, and it didn't really do it for me either. Mm-hmm. And here's the thing, like, there's certain, I think if it was like the right license, I guess, because I remember liking Lego Star Wars when I played them at other people's houses. Mm-hmm. And then I had kind of, you know, it was by the time that they were old and I hadn't played them. And so I just kind of moved on. I never owned it myself. So I'm really excited for a new one now that I can try it out. So I'm very, very curious about this game, especially because the old Lego Star Wars games were like, this one is, first one was classic trilogy, right? And had 3 movies to pull levels from. And the second one was prequel, I think. So I'm really curious how they're going to have to make a whole game out of 1 movie.
Yeah. So. And I heard they're going to do something where they like sort of bridge the gap between Jedi and The Force Awakens.
Yeah.
Like, so I don't know if it was going to, did they say it was going to be DLC or is it actually part of the game?
I think that's actually part of the game from the bat.
Yeah, I was going to say, I read an article that said there was going to be more story and stuff, for instance, like why C-3PO's arm is red.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Was one of the things that they very pointedly mentioned in the article. and just more backstory, I guess, which is interesting that you're going to get it in a Lego game. So that's cool. That's cool, I guess.
Now, will it be considered canon?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it is. They're working with LucasArts to make sure. There can't be any like big reveals, I would assume, from the like Lego game. But
suddenly tell us where Snoke came from.
Yeah. So I'm curious what I'm sure, you know, I think the C-3PO is like a nice little fun story,
but
they'll be able to hear.
Think about it, though. How much would the internet blow up if they just like you beat the game and you find out this incredible thing from the Lego game?
Yeah.
It would be kind of crazy.
Yeah. I really hope that there's some kind of connection between C-3PO's red arm and Metal Gear Solid 5. Just because J.J. Abrams is like known that he really respects Kojima, and Kojima really likes J.J. Abrams. When Kojima was on his tour with Mark Cerny from Sony, there's a picture of they got to meet each other and like hang out, and they like signed each other's, you know, work and stuff like that.
That's awesome.
So I'm wondering if JJ was like, hey, we can give C-3PO red arm, kind of like Snake. So I don't know. I'm holding out for that one.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I mean, JJ Abrams is definitely a gamer. I was just reading the other day, I can't remember what game it was, but he like reached out to a developer of some game and was like, dude, the intro to your game is the best thing I've ever played or something like that. And I was just like, man, he seems like such a cool dude, you know. And JJ, if you're watching this podcast, can I just meet you and be your best friend,
please?
Thanks, JJ.
Thanks. You're the best.
I have a small JJ story. Is that when I was doing my internship at this place in Pittsburgh, I was explaining to one of the animators there. I'm like, yeah, I've been watching the show Person of Interest. JJ Abrams is the producer, and he's like, oh yeah, JJ. I met him once. I was interviewing to work for Bad Robot.
Oh, wow.
And he's like, I didn't end up getting the job, but JJ told me he really was interested in my work and was going to keep my number.
Whoa.
And would probably call me. I was like, dude.
Wow.
He met with the man, JJ, the savior of Star Wars.
That's
the one and only.
Yeah. And who did you see off in the distance? You're like, oh, that guy met JJ, the guy from Star Trek.
We were the one day when I was in the office for this internship, Zachary Quinto was there.
Oh, wow.
Because they were doing some show that they were going to film in Pittsburgh. And I'm like, oh, Spock is here today.
JJ.
He knows JJ. So,
that's awesome.
Yeah, that was a really, really weird day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Man, that's crazy.
Speaking of TV type stuff, Titanfall 2 has been announced that they're working on, first of all, a campaign, single player campaign.
That's pretty cool.
So not that halfway multiplayer, not really campaign. Mm-hmm. But they're also working on some kind of TV series as a spinoff of the show. I mean, of the game.
Hmm.
Yeah, but why?
But
yeah, exactly. Why? That's what
I'm
wondering.
But why?
That's what I was thinking. I'm like, you know, if they had that campaign in the first game where you could get us really interested about this world, then maybe right now we'd be excited.
Yeah, exactly.
But of all the TV show or of all the games I would want to have a TV show, Titanfall is like bottom of the list.
Yeah, but Dustin, but why? Someone needs to answer my question.
No one knows
fucking why.
We
money.
Can't answer it because it makes no sense, because the first one was like, hey, here's sort of a story.
Yeah.
In between loading screens.
Here's
some shit.
Because EA or I guess it might not. No, EA is the publisher. I can't remember who's the developer, but they're so confident in this single player campaign that they know they're going to be able to sell you on watching their shitty TV show.
On ABC Family this summer.
Well, and here's the other thing. I don't. Video game TV shows have not in the past does not inspire any confidence that this is going to be any good. Namely that Halo show came with Master Chief Collection.
Didn't that go straight to Netflix or something?
Well, if you bought Master Chief Collection, you had access to the show. Nightfall. That was
okay. Yeah, Nightfall.
Did you watch that at all, David?
No.
It was not real bad. I mean, it wasn't bad, but it was not good at all.
Wasn't Locke in it, though? Wasn't Idris his name? Idris Elba in that?
Yeah, he was, I think, the main character of the show. I think I watched the first episode, and it just felt like a bad sci-fi show.
Oh, that's a bummer.
Like, just
like
not
Sharknado
good.
3.
Yeah, something along those lines.
I don't know. Those movies are actually pretty hilarious.
So I'm really curious about Titanfall 2 overall. I felt like, I think last week we talked about this, Brandon, that Titanfall 1 had a huge potential, but it had no legs. So, David, did you play Titanfall at all?
I did. I played through the quote-unquote campaign.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was fun, and then I was done. Like, I never touched it after that. I even bought it on Xbox One when I got my Xbox One because I'm like, well, maybe I'll play it over here. And I didn't at all.
Yeah.
And not to say I didn't like it. I think for me the big problem was no one I knew was playing it. Like, literally zero people that I knew had the game. So, and that's one of those, you know, if it's an online game, you definitely want to play it with people you know. Otherwise, maybe I'm just weird, but I like to play games with people I know. Mm-hmm. Well, but I will say, I think as to why that they're making a TV show, I think this is a reaction to Activision announcing recently that they were going to start like developing TV shows for.
Oh, yeah.
I think they talked a little bit, like, I think they said they were going to do something with Overwatch. I know they're doing like little game, like little cinematics outside the game. And they said they're going to be developing more of their properties into TV shows and stuff. So I'm thinking that this is a direct reaction to that, because EA and Activision are like sort of like, mm-hmm. you know, they're the two competitors, you know, like trying to outdo each other. Mm-hmm. So
they want to make sure that Activision doesn't get all of it to themselves as far as this TV business is concerned.
Yeah. So. And content creation is kind of like this big thing now. Like, you know, Netflix, Hulu and Amazon are getting into it. Like, everyone wants to get into content creation.
Even Ubisoft with the Assassin's Creed movie.
Yeah. Yeah, well. Exactly. So, you know, it's just this thing. It's the big thing right now, basically.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, but EA has that EA Sports voice guy.
Uh-huh. That will probably sell it.
It's in the games.
Yeah. So maybe they could just get him to narrate the Titanfall show. That'd be pretty awesome.
That could be something.
I like it. I think we're onto something here.
Interesting. So I'm the thing that I think is really going to give Titanfall 2 the edge over its predecessor will be the fact that it is going to be multi-platform.
Oh, it's going to sell, if you'll pardon me reappropriating something from my show, it's going to sell like hotcakes.
Hotcakes. Because, yes. Yeah,
everyone has wanted, like, all the PS4 people wanted to play Titanfall and they couldn't. So now Titanfall 2 will come out. They'll all get to play it. I'll have friends that actually play it. And I'm pretty excited about that.
I'm always curious if those deals, like for, you know, Titanfall 1 exclusive on Xbox One, I wonder if the amount of money that Microsoft paid them was worth not releasing it on PS4.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like, personally, I feel like the answer is no. Like, because it's sold, you know, what, a quarter of what it could have? I don't know, maybe half of what it could have.
I guess one thought is EA is like, hey, this is a new IP. Mm-hmm. So who knows? You know, new IPs are very, very difficult. So maybe they were like, let's play it safe and take the money. And in the end, we'll be able to make more money. If it does really well, we'll still be able to do it on the next one, multiplat, mm-hmm. and make all the money there. So,
yeah,
very interesting. Okay, so the next thing I have is a really interesting story, and that has to do with some Xbox One backwards compatibility. So earlier, a couple days ago, people realized that Red Dead Redemption was totally downloadable on Xbox One for backwards compatibility. And then, so let's see, you had to search for a certain person. You had to search for the person Rocco Howard is what I'm reading here on Reddit. And once you find that user, you view their profile, go to games, find Red Dead Redemption, and then click install if you had it previously purchased on your account. And then it would work.
Wow.
So somebody at Microsoft like dropped the ball or something, that like there was this loophole, because I don't think it was quite ready yet.
Yeah.
So, but I guess now they have removed that option and now you're not able to do that at all.
Yeah. Do you know if they removed it for people that already have it? Like, did they just totally take it all away?
This person on Reddit says, looks like you can still play it if you managed to download the game last night. All you need to do is go into offline mode on your Xbox One, then boot up the game.
What happens if you try to do an online mode?
I'm guessing that it just says, like, you don't have the license, or maybe, I don't know.
That's weird. Why would they undo something? Like, this is something that keeps happening, though, on the internet. Like, something will get released on the internet and then they'll like try to take it off the internet. But the problem is once something's on the internet, it's there and it's not going anywhere. So I don't know.
My theory is because I don't have the exact comment. Microsoft made a comment that basically said, we make sure that all of our games go through proper testing to make sure that they work properly on Xbox One when they're brought back or when they're brought forward, I guess. So my guess is this guy that you could had to follow and see the game was either a tester or some kind of developer on the backwards compatibility team that they're still doing like certification, things like that, bug testing to make sure it works. And it's just not quite ready yet, if I had to guess. So should be interesting. I'm very excited for that game to be backwards compatibility because I think I'm at the point now where I'm ready to go back and check it out.
Yeah, and I guess that also is sort of a confirmation that they're not, like, working on a remaster, you know?
Yeah, because, which is kind of disappointing, but...
Yeah, it's a little bit of a bummer. But I probably wouldn't have rebought it anyway, so... I don't know.
Yeah.
It's a tough call. I think it's probably the smart move to just make it backwards compatible. And it'll look a little bit better because they run slightly higher resolution sometimes, blah, 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 but... Do you think that they're making Red Dead Redemption 2?
You would have to assume. I mean, it's if they're not making it, they're really leaving money on the table because it was so huge when it came out.
Yeah, I was going to say, and so many people are interested in this backwards compatible now. So it just shows that still the want is there.
Yeah,
so
the interest for Red Dead is definitely there and it hasn't gone away. I think when you see like... top games of the generation, when you're talking about 360 and PS3, that game is always top five, at least top 10. So very interesting. I would love to see Rockstar return on that game, but they're so secretive about what they're doing that we probably won't know for another year or so. So,
and then it'll come out like 2 years after that or something like with GTA.
Yeah, exactly. Man, that GTA launch cycle felt like it was forever.
Yeah,
because I think it was
forever. That's why it felt that way.
That launched when they originally announced it, Brandon. I remember us talking about it at lunch in high school, right at the beginning of the year of our senior year, and it didn't come out until like when we were in college, like that next September. So it was like I think a year and a half or so, something like that. Anyway. So I've been trying to incorporate one fun story of the week, and this one has to do with Sonic the Hedgehog and whoever runs that Twitter account.
They are a genius.
Dude, okay.
Whoever runs that Twitter account.
Brandon, you haven't heard this at all, have you?
I have not.
Okay, YouTube Gaming posts a tweet that says, RIP at Sonic the Hedgehog, and then they link to a video said, if video game weapons actually worked, and there's this little gif that shows up with Sonic trying to fight somebody, and he just gets split in half, as Brandon can see right here. Sonic the Hedgehog, the official account, replies, RIP YouTube Gaming, with nothing but a picture of Twitch, the Twitch logo. Shots fired.
That's so good.
Man, like, YouTube Gaming, what even happened to that? Does anybody use it?
Nothing happened to it.
No, nothing has happened, and it's still not happening. And it's Google and it's YouTube, so it'll never really like go away. But they'll just keep pushing it to the side, like they did with Google Plus, which nobody ever uses, but it's still there. It still exists.
It's interesting. Google is like not really good at creating services, but they're really good at buying them.
Yeah,
like they bought YouTube, and so that's why YouTube is doing so well. But like, I guess maybe Gmail, but Google Plus, no good. Google, remember Google Buzz?
I do remember Google Buzz. I used it maybe 3 times, and then after that, I just sent all my tweets to Google Buzz.
Like, yeah,
pretending I was using it, but not actually.
I even remember there was a huge hype behind Google Wave.
Oh my gosh! Yes, yeah. I remember that.
And then like everyone used it, and they're like, yeah, I'm just going to use email, I think.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, exactly.
So that's it for my my side quests.
Mm.
Brandon, did I miss anything?
No, that sounds pretty good to me.
Okay, so we're going to move into our new segment I'm very excited about.
All right.
And that is Name That Review Score. And so I came up with this because I was thinking, I'm like, man, I love looking at the review averages I love to guess how well a game is going to do or not going to do. Mm-hmm. I think I've become pretty good at guessing the scores. For example, today, the review scores for Unraveled and Firewatch came out. And I was thinking, I'm like, man, those games are going to get right around 80. And they're sitting at 81 right now.
Wow.
But I never said that out loud, so I didn't get any satisfaction of being
yes, you're not nobody's going to give you any props for that.
Exactly. So this is the show where, and what's going to happen is that since we're starting this segment, I'm going to instantly start to fail. So we have two games up, and one of them is actually a DLC, but it's a very large expansion. First one is Dying Light the Following, and the second one is Street Fighter V.
Oh.
Now, the criteria for this segment is that we're going to be using opencritic.com, which is kind of like Metacritic, only they're much more selective about what sites they use. It's very awesome. I always see people on Reddit posting about OpenCritic, so I think people are moving away from Metacritic, hopefully.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. Hmm. So let's start out with Dying Light. Brandon, on a scale of 1 to 100, what do you think Dying Light the Following will get?
78.
78. Any reason behind that? I'm curious to hear.
I don't know. I don't know. I've talked to a couple. This is the problem I'm having with this, is I've only talked to a couple people who have even played the original game. Okay. So I'm basing it off what they told me. And from their reaction, it seems like about a 78. So no solid reason behind that number. But big DLC. I've heard okay things. 78.
Interesting. Hmm. David, your thoughts?
So I know that critics were not super kind to the original Dying Light. Like, it kind of was like right along the, you know, the 80 score range, right? Mm. Yeah, I'm not crazy about that.
I have it up. Dying Light came out before OpenCritic existed. So on the Metacritic, the PC version has a 75.
Okay, so I would say, yeah, that's like a C. And so, yeah, you know, I hate saying the same thing that Brandon said, but like I'm feeling like, how about this? I'll say like 76.
76.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to have to go, I'm going to go 83. And here's why. Hearing a lot of press and stuff about this game is a lot of people say that it's like a sleeper hit, and it had some problems, but a lot of them either were patched out and overall a great game with some flaws. So I'm thinking that this is their chance to fix things up and release something that will be better than the original product. Because this is a really expensive DLC. I think it's $30.
Wow.
Yeah, didn't you say it's like a whole game, though?
Yeah. I think they said that the open world is bigger than the original game in this DLC.
Crazy.
So I'm honestly thinking that 83 might be low. I'm very curious next week how this will unfold. I'm already really excited about this segment.
Man.
Okay. So we have 78, 76, 83. A nice spectrum there.
And what's nice is if I'm not right, it doesn't really matter. I won't be here next week to like have to like, you know, blush and get really embarrassed, you know?
Yeah. So I think what we're going to do is, and I'm trying to make a way that this isn't confusing.
Okay.
Our idea was like, whatever the actual score is, you have to subtract the difference. So like, let's say I was 3 points off, then that puts me at a -3 for my score.
Okay.
But if you get it right, you get +2. So inevitably, probably you're going to be in the negative throughout the duration of however long we do this.
I think it should just be whoever wins that week.
That's a good idea. That really does simplify.
And then like a +1 if you want to do it like that. Say like I won 1 week, and then after,
and then 1 year we can have a nice trophy.
I can just like,
yeah, I like that. Okay,
poop on you.
So, next one.
I don't recommend that. isn't that how E. coli spreads?
Yeah, potentially.
Ebola or something, I don't know.
Ebola, yeah.
Ebola?
Ebola.
Okay.
Ebola.
Next one, Street Fighter V. Brandon, your thoughts?
Oh, I think this is going to be a beautiful game.
Okay.
90.
Whoa.
95.
Okay. Now, David, before you go ahead and guess, you're allowed to do some research beforehand.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing right now.
Street Fighter 4.
That's
on
what I'm
PS3,
looking at right
94
now.
That's what, on Metacritic.
That's why I picked 95.
It's at 94.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. That's already surprising to me.
You got some new characters. They look super fucking awesome. I've seen a couple of them. And we got that new one introduced at PXX.
Mm.
I think it's going to be good, man.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Brandon, what was your answer?
95.
Okay, so this is tough. Mike, if he were here, he would hate me for saying this, but I'm not the biggest like fighting game fan. So the fact that Street Fighter 4 got a 94,
that's crazy to me still.
Blows my mind. That is a high score.
It's very high.
So I'm guessing is it the same team making 5 that made 4?
I believe so. It just has Capcom as the publisher, I believe, and developer.
Okay.
Let me look here.
What was GTA? Was that a 90?
Eight. Yeah, so they're the developer. They're 94. Publishing it and developing it. So,
okay, I'm gonna say it has a lot of hype, and maybe it won't live up to the hype.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still gonna be like 93. That's what I'm gonna say.
Okay, so 93. Interesting. Okay,
I thought he was just gonna come out with something just crazy. Like it has a lot of hype. 78.
Okay. So my thoughts are, this generation especially, reviewers have been really hard on games. I think we might have one game that have hit 95 this entire generation.
Yeah.
I think that which here's the thing, Street Fighter fans, if they don't change it up enough, they're going to complain it's the same game. And if they change too much, they're going to say that they've changed the formula. Yeah. So I'm thinking this game is going to get closer to a straight 90, but potentially less. I'm going to go 88.
Oh, man.
Good
guess.
So on that, we have 95, 93, 88. A nice little spectrum there across the board.
Wow.
So next week when we tune in, we'll be able to find out. I'm hoping, because they haven't said if the review embargo comes out Monday or Tuesday. So hopefully we'll be able to check in next week. Check out the scores and see how it goes. I'm very excited about this game. I feel like
you're going to win, you bitch.
Here's the thing. I think I'm going to win.
Yeah, you bitch. That's why you made it.
I think I'm going to win. But I know that now that like there's a camera and we're putting this out, I'm going to totally lose.
That's how it always
works.
That's
how it always works.
It's like those particles in what is it called? Quantum physics, where you know, you can like send information over them, but then when you observe them, the information changes, or I don't know. Never mind. I'm not smart enough to make this joke, so I give up.
I think this is the first time science has ever been mentioned on this podcast.
Yeah, it's like quantum particles. They behave one way, and then when they're observed, they behave another way.
Mm.
It's really tricky and weird, and I don't know why it happens.
That's the smartest thing that's ever been said on this podcast.
Oh, man, really?
That's very true.
You get 1 point on the game.
You get 1 point on the game automatically.
Oh, man. I should bring up more science stuff.
So I have a topic for us.
All
right. I'm very interested. This one is something I read on Reddit, and I'd like to just read what this guy posted.
Read what
I read on Reddit and see what you guys think about it. The Reddit user, his name is A Year of Prompts. So shout out to him.
All right. A year of prompts?
Prompts, like a reading prompt.
Okay.
Or a writing prompt.
Right. One year.
Yeah, a whole year. So this is on the PS4 subreddit. And the title of his post says, "Hard drive creep is becoming a real concern. Devs need to stop auto-bloating their games after purchase."
Oh.
So here's what he has to say. I own a lot of PS4 games digitally, enough that I can't have them all installed at once. That's not a problem because I don't play most of them regularly. Though I do like to have as many available at once as I can. Lately, though, I've been having real issues with losing space from automatic updates, mostly those that decide that they will download the full DLC content even if I haven't purchased it.
Oh, man.
He goes on to say, today, Activision is eating up an additional 9 gigabytes of storage from their new Call of Duty 3 Black Ops 3 DLC by including it as part of a patch which means to keep playing the game, I have to remove one or two games from my hard drive, even though I have no interest in buying the new content. That's some grade A crap. And while I understand it's easy to dismiss as not a big deal, it actually is for me, reducing my enjoyment of my PS4 and will sway my opinion on buying other Activision games. Patches I have no problem with when they increase file size, but forcing me to store DLC on my system I don't own is rather entitled on the publisher's part.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
Brandon, you and I both dealt with some space issues earlier this year.
Yeah.
Late last year.
Yeah, it was interesting. It was affecting me enough that we actually bought another hard drive.
Yeah.
So I never really thought about it that way, actually. I just bought the whatever the new Call of Duty DLC was, and it was, I didn't have to download
Instant.
Shit. And
yeah,
I was
you already did.
What happened? And then I realized just now that that makes complete sense.
Mm-hmm.
But I did buy it, so I don't care.
Here's my problem.
Oh, man.
So no, not only is it annoying to store this stuff on your hard drive, but it is super annoying if you live in an area like we do where there is data caps on how much you can download.
Oh, so really? Every you have data caps?
We do. We live in the ancient world here, David, of Butler, Pennsylvania, north of Pittsburgh.
I've heard tale of data caps, but I've never encountered one.
So in our area, if you get just internet from our local internet service provider, you get, I think, 250 gigs. And if you buy the complete package that includes TV and stuff like that, you get 350. So
are we using up some of those gigs right now?
No, because my wife works for the cable provider and I get unlimited. So there you go. I'm one of the very lucky few in the area that gets to enjoy this privilege. But I lived many years under that data cap. So I understand
the struggle.
When
the struggle is hashtag the struggle.
You know, when there's 2 days left before your billing cycle's over, you just got to get that one more episode of Lost in. But those data caps keeping you down.
Oh my gosh.
So it really is annoying when, you know, like I said, when you're on a data cap and they're forcing you to download the stuff you don't even want.
Yeah, no, that's really annoying. You know, it's funny. I'd never consciously thought about this thing happening where, you know, if you have games installed, every time you update them, they're using up more and more space. And that sucks.
Yeah.
Especially because like most PS4 hard drives are like 500 gigabytes, right?
Yeah. So, it starts. Well, they do have the 1 terabyte model now.
Well, yeah, the newer ones. But like if you bought it launch day, like I did,
yeah,
you're stuck at 500. I've had to delete stuff like crazy. I used to have maybe a fourth more games than I have installed now. Mm. And like, you know, every month I have to delete more and more stuff, and
dude,
I don't even bother downloading like the free games anymore. Like I just add them to my account and don't install them unless I'm planning on actively playing them.
Yeah.
And that's only going to get worse. And I thought about like buying a hard drive upgrade for my PS4 because it's actually like kind of easy to do.
It's super easy. I highly recommend
it. But however, I have PT installed on my PS4 and I don't want to lose it.
Well, I'm pretty sure.
And if I replace my hard drive, I'm going to lose it, right?
I don't think so. Because, okay, here's what you need to do. I believe when Brandon and I did this, you can transfer everything on your PS4 to an external, then replace your hard drive, and then transfer everything back on. And I believe I read online.
PS4 supports externals?
No. It supports external backup. So you can't extend your storage with an external, but you can back it up, change out your hard drive, and then put everything back on. And I believe you can keep PT when you do that.
Hmm.
I think.
All right. Well, I'll have to look more into this because I'm definitely ready for more space on my PS4.
Brandon, do we have 2 terabytes now, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And it's been fantastic.
Oh,
I just
nice.
Going into my memory bar and looking at how much memory I have.
Yeah.
It's comforting. I just download everything.
You can, and you can keep it on there pretty much. I think probably in about a year, maybe a year and a half, we're going to start to run into issues.
By then, the shit that I downloaded will be so old that it...
Well, yeah, and the turnover of games, you can just delete it. But so, yeah, it's very interesting. I'm curious if this will start to become more of a problem and people will really start complaining. This post on Reddit had 707 upvotes on the PS4 wow. Reddit. So obviously, and 327 comments. So obviously this is a topic of interest for other PS4 users, but it is weird and always unsettling to me when especially, so it's one thing to like bloat up your game and stuff like that, but to bloat it up with content that like you need to unlock kind of weird to me.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you guys think?
Well, yeah. Yeah. I mean, like,
sorry, I didn't mean to step
no,
on
no,
you,
no.
But
no, I mean, like something that's interesting is if the first DLC is 9 gigabytes, there's 3 more that could be potentially 9 gigabytes coming
that
way.
Oh, jeez.
Think about that.
I didn't even think about that.
Think about how much, you know what I mean?
That's a lot.
So 9 gigs, 3 DLCs, that's how many? 9 times 3.
No. There's 4 total and there's already 1 hour. So.
Jeez. So like, it's a 50 gig game. I'm really bad at math, especially when I'm trying to podcast. It's 50 gigs plus 9 times 4. What's that, Brandon?
Almost 100. Close enough.
I didn't graduate college, damn it.
Yeah, I graduated college, but I haven't taken a math class in like, 15 years? 15 years.
You're adding 36 gigs, potentially. So 5, 6, 7, 8. That game will be close to 86 gigs when it's all said and done. On your hard
drive.
That's
too many gigs.
Whether or not you buy all that DLC or not.
Activision, Jeez. That's too many gigs. Don't make me download DLC I don't own. Thank
exactly.
you.
Exactly. Yeah.
The end.
Okay. So do we have any other comments about this before we move on? We good?
It sucks. There
it,
we go.
It sucks. Yeah. Okay. So I asked you guys a question before we started the show, and I'm very curious what your thoughts are. So there's all these crappy celebrity apps out there. You've probably heard of the Kim Kardashian app, right?
Yeah.
What
I've heard
do
that
you
it's
do
pretty
that
successful
app?
Actually.
Yeah, they make a ton of money off them. I don't I've never played the app myself. So I don't actually know what you
nope.
do.
Let's do a let's play.
I'm assuming yes.
Sounds like a good idea, guys.
I'm assuming it's kind of like a Farmville type like build up your fame and career type stuff by spending 99 cents
like plant something and then wait 24 hours and then
yeah.
and mascara
come back.
Mascara will grow out of the ground.
Exactly. Yeah. So one of the big things I read this week is that Taylor Swift is working with one of these developers to launch her own mobile game.
Oh, great.
Now, I'm a big fan of T-Swift myself. So if it's free, I might give it a download. I don't know about you guys.
I'm
mainly for the comic relief of checking out this low level entertainment, and but I do like Taylor Swift.
I'm not
unashamed.
Even there. I'm not even there.
Okay, so that well that leads me to my question.
I
then.
I just can't even with this game.
You can't even, so. Yeah. So my question is, we have all these celebrities releasing games. What celebrity would you want to release a game, and what would you do in it?
Wow.
Yeah,
Brandon,
I'm ready. I'm ready.
Take us away.
My initial thought was Gilbert Godfrey. That was my initial thought.
Oh my gosh. Just talking like Iago at you all the time.
Yeah. I don't know what exactly he would be doing. I would just like to live his life as him, just talking to normal people.
I heard he does a podcast now.
Wow.
Yeah, I've heard that too, actually. That podcast I mentioned earlier, Comedy Bang Bang, he's on the episode I'm listening to right now.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Your ears may or may not bleed.
You know, I heard once, I saw on YouTube that voice is totally a character. Like, that's not how he normally
supposedly
talks.
That is not how he talks. Yeah, but even on this podcast, he's being himself and he's doing that voice. So
yeah,
I think he just has to do it now or we're just not going to recognize
You're
him
like,
anymore.
That's not Gilbert. That's not him.
That's not the Gilbert we know and love.
Yeah.
But, that's right. Yeah, I don't know what he would be doing in this app exactly. I haven't really thought that through, but I just need to hear that voice.
Podcasting.
Blaring through my speakers.
Going to Aladdin signings as, you know, he was the parrot, right?
Yeah, Iago.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Clearly.
Interesting.
Clearly you guys know who Iago is, right?
That, you know, I do remember Aladdin was maybe just slightly before my time, but I do remember it. What year
it's
did Aladdin come out?
It's timeless. Huh?
Do you remember what year Aladdin came out?
I want to say it was like 93.
Oh, Well, that was the year I was born.
1 year before I was born.
See, my goal with the Super Best Friends is anytime they mention all the, you know, old games or something, I like to remind them that I'm
92.
Like, I was like, hey, I was not born yet, or I was 1 year old.
Well, here, in my defense, I grew up watching Pinocchio and Bambi and the Jungle Book, and those were all made way before I was born.
That's true. So, that's true.
The app that, or the person I want to see make an app, is Kanye West.
I was hoping that one of the two of you would say that.
Kim and Kanye.
Yeah, because we're already there. I want that app to let Taylor Swift's app finish, but he wants to talk about Beyonce's app being the best app of all time.
It starts to download and it changes. Like, you start to download the Taylor Swift app and it just changes midway. He's like, I'm gonna let you finish downloading, but the Kanye app is the best app of all time.
And then you download
it. Beyonce. It has to be the Beyonce.
Oh, yeah, the Beyonce app is the best app of all time.
Amber Rose app comes in and starts fingering it.
Oh, good Lord.
In the butthole. We talked about this earlier. I just I couldn't not mention Amber Rose.
An interesting Twitter predicament.
That hashtag, though.
You're talking about Kanye. Now you have to talk about Amber.
Yeah. Very, very interesting.
I actually don't know what she looks like. I've never seen Amber Rose before.
She is a very voluptuous, perfectly describes her. She's a very curvy woman.
Mm.
Bald, blonde hair.
I'm like, doesn't she have no hair?
Yeah.
But
I thought
I was going to sound really ignorant saying that, but
no,
I was right.
No. She has a very, very short buzz cut that's dyed blonde.
I've never seen this girl before in my life. So good for her for getting famous.
I was going to say, that is Amber Rose.
Huh. Interesting. All right.
Fair
enough. I don't know what to say to that.
Interesting. You know, I was supposed to think of one, and I didn't come up with one because I was
snap!
Because I was trying to make sure I had the rest of the show planned out. I like the Kanye though. I think the Kanye app could be very interesting. Like, one of the things you have to do is tweet something really arrogant, and then that boosts up your score.
up with shitty fashion.
And then, one of the big microtransactions you have to do is change the name of your album again
to something more conceptual.
Did you see that earlier today? He was like, "Yo, I think there's some secret news about the album name coming out
again."
This would be time number four.
What did I tell you? It's eventually going to be so conceptual that it's going to be like lines and symbols. It's no longer going to be a word. It's not going to be waves anymore. It's going to be like underscore, period, at symbol, money sign.
It means something.
I like it. I like it. Well, here, Brandon, I can give you another potential celebrity if you like.
I'm very interested.
For one, since you don't have one.
Yeah.
I was going to say, what about like Kim Jong-un making an app?
Political leader apps.
The route.
How about that?
You know, I'm wondering if something like that might already exist. I feel like that's such a ripe thing to make a game about.
Like, every day he's talking about how he's going to launch a new rocket, and then you have to, but your goal is to make it look impressive, but it's really not that impressive, you know? Like, so you just have to keep, your BS game on point, you know?
You got to flex your muscles and do all this crazy stuff, but, you got to watch out. You don't want to get condemned by the UN. You don't want to get any warning shots from North Korea or South Korea.
Exactly. A very thin line. And at the end of the day, you have to pick the most ridiculous haircut possible.
We're going to get hacked by North Korea because of this segment. Yeah.
And every time you show the app to someone from North Korea, they start crying immediately
and
because
bowing
they love
to
him
you
so much.
Yeah. I like that.
Inside North Korea app.
Kim Jong-un Simulator 2016. Yeah. The works. All right, so I have another topic here. We're actually already at an hour, but we can talk about it if you want. It's up to you guys.
Game, let's do it.
Oh, no. Here, I'll give you an option.
Okay.
One of them is a lot more open-ended. So we could either talk a little bit about Firewatch/Unraveled, which is out today on Wednesday, if you're listening to this. Mm-hmm. Or we can talk a little bit about piracy and The Witness.
Oh,
let's talk about The Witness.
Okay.
Yeah, I feel like we should talk about that one.
So let me bring up, I have a Kotaku article here. Let's see. So this is from Patrick Kelpick, I believe is the last name. And he says, The Witness has been illegally downloaded by thousands of people since it was released last month. But did you know pirates have their own forums, comment sections, technical support questions? Yeah, I was surprised too. It's news that a popular game is being pirated, but The Witness designer, Jonathan Blow, has been actively talking about his interactions with piracy. And Jonathan Blow's tweet says, It seems The Witness is the number one game on a certain popular torrent site. Unfortunately, this will not help us afford to make another game. So the article goes on for a long time talking about piracy. And it was just interesting thinking about... You always, you know, think about games getting pirated and stuff. But in a situation like The Witness, you have the creator coming out and being like, hey, when you pirate this game, it doesn't let us make more games. So I'm curious what you guys thinking about pirating games. Have you ever done it? And what are or do you do it now? And what are your thoughts about it? David, why don't you go ahead and go first?
Yeah,
out
sure,
yourself
I'll go
as a the
first...
pirate you are.
Yeah. Oh no. I'm
yeah.
Not, I'm not. So to answer your question, your question about do I pirate games now? I actually don't. I will admit, in the past, I did, especially when I was a poor college student.
I think everyone has at some point.
And like when I was in high school and couldn't afford anything. But back then, it was like a million times easier to pirate games. Like you could just go on websites that you could just download a couple links and then zip them all together, and
yeah.
Then you have the game. And that like, it was like so easy. I think they called them like Zero Day or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But like, and then also when Dreamcast came out and I was in college and I couldn't afford games, I totally admit that I did that.
The thing where you could burn the
hack.
Games.
Yeah, you could burn
Man,
the games.
Man, I remember
and,
that.
I mean, I feel terrible about it now. Like I was one of the reasons the Dreamcast failed. But, you know, at the time I just wasn't considering the repercussions, you know? So all that said, I will say that didn't they also talk about how like incredibly successful The Witness has been?
Yeah.
Like, wasn't Jonathan Blow talking about how he had already sold more copies of the game of The Witness in the first week that he sold in the first year of Braid? Is
yeah,
that right?
I think the actual term was he said he made more revenue from it. So, and it, which makes sense being that, you know, The Witness $40 versus I believe $15,
something like that. It was tough because it was like weird Microsoft bucks back then, so
yeah.
or PS3 bucks or mm-hmm. whatever. But
still, I believe he made a crap ton more money,
yeah.
regardless of how much it was priced at.
So it's weird because I knew he had talked about the Witness getting like pirated a lot, but I didn't realize he said something like this is not helping us afford to make another game. Meanwhile, he said in another article how much money he's been making. Like, it's kind of a weird, like, double speak kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying he's lying or wrong. And I definitely think, you know, pirating a game that someone worked really hard on is wrong morally.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. It's a weird, like, double speak kind of thing. That's just bugging me a little bit. But also, I'm not the biggest Jonathan Blow fan in general.
Really?
I'm
curious
yeah,
about that.
It has nothing to do with like him necessarily. I just haven't really liked any of his games yet. And,
yeah.
and that's because of my whole like I hate indie games kind of thing. Like if you
listen
to
Brandon
Super
Best
Friends video game.
yeah.
What was that?
You and Brandon would get along. Cuz Brandon
yeah,
I'm not really big into it.
I get so bored and like they're usually like too simple and I could keep going, but I don't want to make too many enemies
yeah.
on your show. But anyway, so I definitely respect him as like a creative individual, but you know, he's just a guy that makes games to me.
Yeah.
So. Well, I don't know where I'm going with this anymore. Someone bail me out.
It's been interesting just because, you know, some people will say like, well, just because a game is torrented doesn't mean that it's a lost sale because there's people that just want to check it out. And someone from the team on The Witness says, for your does it impact sales question, my first indication is that we hit a big torrent site. That when they hit a big torrent site, their Steam sales graph took a huge dump, is what he said. So it is interesting because I believe that, yeah, there are some people out there that will torrent a game just to try it to see if it works. But honestly, I don't really see people needing to do that anymore now with Steam having their own refund system.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
And plus, like, you know, you could always just wait for the next Steam sale, you know, like Steam is so good about, and that's the reason I don't pirate anymore is because like, if there's a game that comes out that I'm like, oh, that looks kind of interesting, I'll just wait for a Steam sale.
Yeah.
And then I do, and I get it for like under $20 and I'm happy. Like that new game coming out that you, one of the potential topics, Firewatch, I'm just going to wait for a Steam sale for that. And then I'll play it, you know, for however cheap it gets. Mm-hmm. So
it is interesting. Yeah. I think you and I are very similar. When I was like in high school, I didn't have a job. And so I did end up torrenting a bunch of games. What I did find though, is that like torrenting games was never worth it. Cause there was like, you always had to be like, okay, make sure I download a good one that doesn't have any viruses. And if it does work, I mean, if it doesn't have viruses, does it work properly? Is it going to have the right patches? Like, it was never an optimal experience. And even then, so even though I did had, you know, pirated certain games, I tried to avoid it as much as possible just because I didn't want to have that terrible experience. And now that I'm a big boy, for the most part, you know, you can just buy it and get the good experience. So, and I don't know, I do understand now, like when you're in high school, you just like, yeah, I'm going to download, I don't care. But you know, when you start to realize like, hey, there's someone behind the computer that made that game and this is how they live, you know, you don't really have those exact same morals. Not that you don't have morals as a high school student, but it's not quite the same, I guess.
Yeah.
So
yeah, you just, yeah, you kind of like grow up and kind of understand the way the world works a little better. And, you know, just, you just think about, I don't know, you just think about the repercussions and you're able to like put yourself in someone else's shoes as you meet more and more kinds of people. So
exactly.
Brandon,
have you ever pirated a game?
Yeah. I was just thinking about it. It's really interesting about, this is a little sidestep about the Steam sale thing. Like, let's just say The Witness 2 was trying to come out, and let's just say theoretically that it couldn't because of this. That's just something that's crazy to think of because it's so successful, and you know, heaven forbid, you know, these big budget games. But that's just interesting. I tried once to answer your question. It was for Skyrim, the full collector's edition of that, and I actually already owned it.
Yeah.
On Xbox 360, I just wanted to play it on my computer, and I was so worried that I was going to get a virus and it wasn't working for many reasons, because I tried to put a Windows partition on my Mac, and that's just, like, bad. And so I just canceled it hardly at all into it and just decided never again.
Interesting. Sorry, if I looked concerned on the video version of the show, I thought I just heard, like, a real big bang. Did you hear that, Brandon?
I did too. I actually felt it in my feet.
Yikes. Okay. Well, maybe it's time to wrap up the show. Anyway, pirating
is blown up, guys. Yeah. New York's fine, though. I didn't hear any bangs.
Well, that's good.
Good on your end.
So, pirating, real bad. Don't do it. Especially don't do it to Jonathan Blow, because it makes him real mad.
Or Metallica. Yeah, he does not like it, and he will talk about you in blog articles.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so let's go ahead and wrap this show up. First of all, David, thank you so much for coming on. We really appreciate it.
Hey, no problem. You know what? I wanted to say, this is my first time like doing anything on camera almost ever. In almost my entire life, I've been like a behind the camera kind of guy.
Yeah.
That's why I got into visual effects. I don't like being, you know, everyone looking at me all the time. So, this was a big step for me. You guys are like helping me in my road to recovery, I would say.
Wow. Good. I'm glad. Well, you know, that's a joke, you're a good looking guy, so you deserve to be in front of the camera. Okay.
Stop it.
I'm just kidding. So where can, if people want to reach out to you, where can they do that at?
Well, I would say I'm most active on Twitter.
Okay.
David J. Tate on there. I Instagram a bit, but pretty much everything I post ends up on Twitter in some form or another. So yeah, that's the best place, I'd say.
Interesting. And also, you can follow the Super Best Friends video game Sleepover on Twitter, right?
That's right. That's SBFVGS podcast on Twitter.
And make sure, if you're listening to this, to go out and check their shop, because it's super awesome. It's lots of good fun.
Best.
I'm not sure about that Taco Douglas character.
No, that guy, I don't know how I feel about him. He has lots of opinions, and I disagree with most of them. So.
Yeah, he gets called out on this show probably once a month, especially because we were calling him out, like saying, hey, you need to get to PlayStation Experience. There's no excuse. You're on the right side of the country.
I know. And
he didn't show.
Didn't do it.
He didn't show.
No. Not cool. Even like, not even interested, it sounds
yeah.
like.
Not
like
cool.
He, I don't know that guy. That
but we
guy.
Do, like, I, you know, it's tough love because we do have that Twitter bromance going on.
No, you guys have like the most adorable Twitter bromance I've
wow.
ever seen.
Wow.
I think he's blushing.
More on that another time.
You can't see it, but I can.
So anyway, one more time, I want to plug tomorrow, Dev Tales will be, it's already out on the iTunes store. So if you're listening to this, search for it. And you can subscribe now, listen to our little preview episode. And then when you wake up Thursday morning, it'll instantly be there, our interview. It's about an hour long with Benjamin Rivers. It's super fun, super interesting. Awesome. The guy has so many awesome stories about how he's doing what he's doing. He actually started by doing like graphic novels and stuff like that. And then was like, hey, I think I can make a game. And he did. And now he's that's what he does full time. So it's really cool to see that progression in his story. So make sure you listen to that. Also, you can follow us on Twitter. I'm at Dustin Cam Fly.
And I am at _ Glorious Ginger.
And go to handsomephantom.com for all of our content. And this Saturday will be the broke-ass stream on Twitch continues.
Officially unofficial, the broke-ass
stream. That's the unofficial name for it, Dave, is the broke-ass stream.
The broke-ass stream, I like it.
Because we only have one microphone, and it's broken, this one little crappy clip-on microphone. And things always go wrong, so that's just, we're just roll with it. So
yeah, that's cool. Nice. I like it.
Awesome. So that wraps this episode up. Thanks again, David, for coming on. And
no problem, guys.
We'll
this
be in touch.
Fun.
Awesome. All right, everybody. We'll see you next week.